to advance just by pressing on here. Okay. I'm happy to stand here and I can advance for you if you like.
Okay. Well, thanks for having me. Today I'm going to talk about work that I've been doing in Drowned River Mouth Lakes. I'm at Grand Valley State University, Muskegon, Michigan. Next slide, please. And I guess just quick, I want to say that I have a lot of collaborators who I've worked with and a lot of different funding sources as well. And I especially want to thank the Great Lakes Fishery Trust for funding especially our yellow perch research. Next slide. Just real brief, so this is where I work in Muskegon at the Lake Michigan Center at Grand Valley State University at the Annis Water Resources Institute. And just not sure how many, I don't know, how many of you have been to Muskegon or Muskegon Lake before? Anybody? Just a couple? Okay, next. Just to give you a sense, that's Muskegon Lake. And you can see it, there's a channel and then that flows into Lake Michigan. And then you can see where AWRI is. That's where our building is located. So we're right on the lake shore in Muskegon. Next. Just to give you an idea. So today I want to talk a little bit about make sure we're all on the sort of same page about what is a drowned river mouth. And then I'll talk about some general work that I've done on fish assemblages in drowned river mouth. And then I'll finish up talking about some work on yellow perch, give you some results and tell you about some new research that we're doing. Next. Just sort of the way I sort of like these simple conceptual models, just to give you a sense. So if you think about Lake Michigan, you know, if you think about these large lake systems, we have the lake on the left, and then you have a whole bunch of tributaries that come in, and then there's these transitional habitats would essentially be the river mouth. And I'm interested in a particular type of river mouth. If you think about these from an ecological point of view, these are tends to be mixing zones. And also, if you just look at human populations on the lakeshore, a lot of times, a lot of our cities are on sort of where these river mouths are. And so that has impacts as well on the habitat. Next slide. So yeah, so there are these sort of transitional habitats. This is the Lake Michigan Basin. And so the drowned river mouths are a particular type of river mouth, and they're basically lake-like habitats that connect tributaries to Lake Michigan. And they occur from sort of about Kalamazoo River north up to about Frankfort. So on the eastern shoreline of Lake Michigan is where you're gonna find these drowned river mouth habitats. And that's essentially a function of the geology of the region. So there's lots of sand dunes, and when lake levels changed as a result of deglaciation, that's how these systems were formed. Next. A little bit about how drowned river mouth lakes are just sort of different if we think about the limnology compared to Lake Michigan. They tend to have warmer water temperatures. So if we like go in the summer, these drowned river mouth lakes are going to tend to be warmer than Lake Michigan. There's going to be less clarity. So the drowned river mouths, you're not going to be able to see as far into the lake as you would if you went out into Lake Michigan. If we looked at the phytoplankton, so the algae in the lakes, there's going to be more of it in the drowned river mouth compared to Lake Michigan. More zooplankton, so the stuff, the little crustaceans in the water that are eating the algae. Again, there's going to be just sort of more productivity in the drowned river mouth lake compared to Lake Michigan. And then the last talk sort of set up the idea that, you know, there's a lot of these quagga and zebra mussels in Lake Michigan. And the ecologists like to call that oligotrophication, and all that is a fancy word that just means those, because of all the filtering that's going on in Lake Michigan, there's like sort of using up all the nutrients. So they're making it basically making Lake Michigan more like Lake Superior, so a more nutrient poor environment. And so if with that going on, these drowned river mouths, embayments, these areas that have a little bit more productivity are probably going to become a bit more important for fisheries in Lake Michigan over time because of the invasive mussels. If we think about, you know, how do fish use these drowned river mouths? So again, we have Lake Michigan. The drowned river mouth is this transitional habitat that connects Lake Michigan to the tributary. We have some fish that like bluegill on the top, pumpkin seed on the bottom, that are probably going to be residents of the drowned river mouth. We have other species like Chinook salmon and lake sturgeon that are going to be, you'll either hear the term adfluvial or sometimes we call it anadromous, but basically they're using the big lake and then they migrate through the downriver mouth to the tributary to spawn. And then we have other species like yellow perch, which I'll talk about, are kind of interesting in that we know there are probably some populations that are resident to the drowned river mouths. There's probably some that are resident to Lake Michigan. And then there's probably these sort of migratory behaviors that maybe some in Lake Michigan will come into drowned river mouths certain times of the year. And then again, you know, just to sort of build on my conceptual model that I'm presenting is, you know, it's not just one drowned river mouth, there's a whole bunch of these. And I think it's also sort of interesting from an ecological point of view to think about that there's, you know, fish that use these drowned river mouths probably primarily, but we have evidence that some of these fish probably do move amongst the drowned river mouths. So they're all connected by Lake Michigan. So that's important to keep in mind. There's also environmental gradients. So the two main gradients I wanna mention today are if you go from south to north, the drowned river mouse in the south tend to be more productive than the drowned river mouse in the north. And then even within drowned river mouse, when you think about the tributary that first enters that drowned river mouse lake, as you get closer to Lake Michigan, there's probably a gradient there as well, where it tends to be more productive closer to the river and less productive as you get closer to Lake Michigan. Here's some data from a former graduate student, Megan Mater. And this is just chlorophyll A concentrations on the left. And that's basically an index of phytoplankton biomass. So the more of that would be more indicative of higher productivity. And then on the, so each point represents a different drowned river mouth lake. And then we just plotted them based on their latitude. So that's sort of, you know, further south to further north. And what you see is there is a negative correlation that's significant that basically just shows that, you know, there is this environmental gradient where there's tends to be higher productivity in the south, lower productivity in the north, but you can see there's certainly some noise associated with that as well. I'll talk a lot about Muskegon Lake, and one of my colleagues, Bopi Badanda, has a buoy in the lake, and it's kind of hard to read the website right here, but if any of you ever go out on Muskegon Lake during the ice-free season, I would encourage you to check this out because you can get the data in real time so you can get a sense of what's going on in the lake, and it even will tell you wind speeds and some things. So especially if you're planning a trip, it would be really helpful if you were going to Muskegon Lake, but it's just www.gvsu.edu/wri/buoy. But you can see in the middle of Muskegon Lake is where my colleague has the buoy, but it's only out there during the ice-free season. We can't keep it out 12 months a year. So we recently took it out. Next slide. But we get some interesting data. He measures a lot of things, but the two things I really want to talk about are water temperature and dissolved oxygen concentrations. And so right here is just on the top is the surface water temperature. And at the bottom, the green line on the bottom is the bottom water temperature. And so I just wanna point out that a lot of these drowned river mouth lakes, as long as they're, you know, tend to be deep enough, which the bigger ones mostly are, you will see they'll stratify during the summer, just like you would expect a typical lake. And so you can see that. And then if we go to the next slide, you'll get some, that's gonna affect dissolved oxygen concentrations. So at the bottom of lakes, when they're thermally stratified, there's less mixing of water at the bottom of the lake because water's different densities. And what you get is you can see here some pretty low dissolved oxygen concentrations approaching zero during the summer, which again is pretty typical of inland lakes that would stratify. So we see some of those same things in a lot of these drowned river mouth lakes. And what's kind of neat though about the drowned river mouth lakes, and this is some data from 2016, which is kind of cool. There's a little animation, you can just run through three of them, is if you look, you'll see these little dips in water temperature at the bottom, and that is likely Lake Michigan water getting pushed into the drowned river mouth lake, so you'll see that signature is colder water, and what happens when you get that Lake Michigan water in, it's colder, has higher oxygen, and you see these pulses of oxygen at the bottom. So it's kind of neat, but it shows that there's a really complex dynamics going on in these drowned river mouth lakes because you're getting, you know, effects from both the tributary and the Great Lake. So So now I want to start kind of give you a sense about the ecology of the drowned river mouth. Now let's talk a little bit about the fish. So most of the data I'm going to talk about, we've collected with fike nets. So we're really focused on the littoral habitat. So those are sort of the habitats along the shoreline where sunlight can reach the bottom is kind of the area. So that's really the habitat that I have a lot of data from. In Muskegon Lake, we use these fike nets, which are basically a passive gear that the fish, you know, if they're swimming along, they come in contact with one of those leads. You have those two wings that come out. So that sort of funnels the fish in. And then the trap, it's essentially like a big lobster trap or a great big minnow trap or something like that, where the fish, there's these funnels. So it's easy for them to swim in, but more difficult to get out. And so we look at what we catch. It's also, I want to just point out that the catch is an index, well, at least we hope it is an index of abundance, but you know, all gears have selectivity. So it's not a perfect representation of what's actually out there. So you always need to keep that a little bit in mind when you're looking at our data. So here's Muskegon Lake. These are the sites we've been sampling. So I've been involved since I've been at Grand Valley. We initiated this long-term project. And so we have data from 2003 through present. I haven't worked up the 2022 data yet, but I'll show you some 2021 data. Next site. So for the first 19 years, we've encountered in these littoral habitats, 58 different species of fish, and we've collected almost 30,000 fish. So we catch those, we measure them, identify them, and let them go. So we've been sampling those four sites, and we set three nets at each site, just to give you a sense. So we do that three times a year. So here's some common species in Muskegon Lake. And if you just run through the animation. So yellow perch is one of the most common, followed by round goby on the right. Blunt-nosed minnow is in the middle. Then we have rock bass on the left, largemouth bass, and then we have bluegill and pumpkin seed. And I think if you added up all those percentages, that's about 75% of the fish we catch are one of those species. So even though we've encountered a lot of species, you can see there's just a sort of a handful of species that tend to be most abundant in the littoral habitat. Next. I've also been doing some work in Lake Makatawa. I don't know if any of you have been to Holland, Michigan before. Nobody? Not a bunch of tulip fans here at the Tulip Festival. But we've been sampling in Lake Makatawa as well. And you can kind of see our sampling sites along the north part of the lake. There I only sample in the fall. We've been doing that for 8 years. And just to give you a sense, we've gotten 39 species of fish over that time period and nearly a little over 12,000. What's kind of interesting though about Lake Makatawa next is that it kind of shows with these passive gear, occasionally you catch a lot of something. And in one particular year, in one single net, we caught over 5,000 brook silverside. So with some of the data I'm going to show, I just kind of exclude that as an outlier and don't take that in. But it gives you a sense of how sometimes dealing with these data can be sort of a give you a headache. So if we exclude that, then we have about 7,000 fish we've collected if we exclude that one net with all those brook silverside. Just sort of a real brief comparison between Lake Makatawa and Muskegon Lake. So if you went out there, you would definitely notice that Lake Makatawa is more eutrophic, more algae in it than Muskegon Lake. And in fact, if you think back to that graph I showed with chlorophyll A, there was the one point that was way higher than everything else, and that point was Lake Makatawa. But just some general comparisons, you can see have just some boxes. So gizzard shad tends to be more abundant in Lake Makatawa than Muskegon Lake. And that tends to be a fish that tends to be more associated with eutrophic conditions. If we look at some of the sunfish, you can see pumpkin seed are about the same in the two, a few more bluegill in Lake Makatawa. One thing that I think is pretty interesting is the rock bass being almost absent from Lake Makatawa, but fairly common in Muskegon Lake. And with some work that I've been doing with some colleagues in Great Lakes Coastal Wetlands, we find that rock bass tend to be an indicator of sort of higher ecological health of sort of littoral wetland habitats. So that kind of matches well with seeing more gizzard shad, less rock bass. We also see more yellow perch, more blunt-nosed minnows. So those would both be positive. But then in Muskegon Lake, we also see more round goby, which is an invasive species. We published a paper a few years ago now, and we looked at 6 different drowned river mouth lakes. And I just wanted to show just one result, and you can just go through the animation quick. There's 3 clusters. But basically what I want to show you is that the fish, so this is a multivariate statistics thing that I'm not going to try to explain. You wouldn't want me to anyways, but the main point here is this is just based on the different fish species we collected in each one. And we use these fancy statistics. We can see there's sort of 3 clusters. And so Kalamazoo Lake is on the left. Lincoln Lake is on the bottom. And then we have, those other clusters. And what we found is like gizzard shad were pretty prominent in Kalamazoo Lake, which tended to have poor water quality, which sort of matches up with the work that I've been doing comparing Muskegon Lake to Lake Macatawa. And then Muskegon Lake, White Lake, and Pentwater Lake, which would be all 3, tend to have a little bit higher water quality among the drowned river mouth lakes, also had yellow perch tended to be more associated with those. So the take-home message from this is just, the fish assemblage out there isn't the same in all of these lakes. It's going to vary lake to lake. So to finish off with, I wanted to talk about work that I've been doing on yellow perch. And so, why are we interested in yellow perch? This is probably a group doesn't take a lot of convincing, right? So it's a fish that lots of anglers like to eat. It's also one that a lot of the agencies are interested in because, you don't need a $100,000 boat or whatever to get out on Lake Michigan to catch yellow perch, right? That's something that people can do from shore. So it's, lots of people have access to them. If we look at the numbers of yellow perch in Lake Michigan, if we think back to like 1980s, 1990s, the abundance was much higher than it is today. So there's been a sort of emphasis to try to understand, are there things we can do to better manage them, to see them, their numbers rebound. The reality is though, they're probably not gonna rebound to those numbers because with things like quagga mussels in the lake is different than it was then. And so we might have to just accept that some of the productivity is just different now under the current current food web. And so one thing that we were interested in with yellow perch and some results I'll present to you today, we're sort of thinking about how much connectivity is there between Lake Michigan and these drowned river mouths. So, are the yellow perch moving back and forth, or are they sort of like separate populations? And so if you talk to some of the anglers on these, they would say, at certain times of the year, if you get the ones, the Lake Michigan fish tend to be more white, the drowned river mouth fish tend to be more yellow, and sort of here's a picture of fish that kind of meet that. But when you started looking at the science, there wasn't a lot of science to see whether or not sort of the anglers, did they have it figured out correct, or were they kind of fooling themselves? And I'll just tell you, the anglers were right. So we could have saved ourselves a lot of money if we'd have just listened to the anglers, but it's nice to have some scientific data to sort of back up what people thought was going on. One of the things we're interested in to start with is we looked at sort of that same work I did in Muskegon Lake. And we looked at years where we caught a lot of juvenile yellow perch. And we were interested, we teamed up with the Michigan DNR. And we wanted to know in those same years that when we'd see a lot of juvenile yellow perch in Muskegon Lake, were those years that we would see a lot in Lake Michigan. And the DNR sampled at 3 spots. So you can see they sampled at Pentwater, there's a star, Grand Haven, and then South Haven. So we're sort of interested in if they're like, ecologists like to call that spatial synchrony. So if it's a good year one place, is it a good year every place? Next. And so what we found was, the top left in yellow is comparing Muskegon Lake to the Lake Michigan catch. And this is just for age 0 yellow perch. And we didn't see a correlation, so it didn't look like a good year in Muskegon Lake wasn't related to a good year in Lake Michigan. But what's interesting, if you look at the three sites in Lake Michigan, which are the other three graphs, there is pretty high correlation among those. So those are all significant relationships. And, you know, some of those is, you know, I should have looked up, but I think it's a couple hundred kilometers distance among the sites. So even though it basically, if it's a good year in Lake Michigan, it's a good year, at least among all three of those sites in southern Lake Michigan, but that doesn't necessarily mean it's a good year in Muskegon Lake. So that sort of tells you, one, there's probably, you know, dispersal dynamics of these age zero is probably not like driving what's going on, at least between the drowned river mouths and the Lake Michigan, or that maybe the environmental conditions that determine what a good year, like those are not going to be the same in Lake Michigan compared to Muskegon Lake. And then I want to talk a little bit about some genetic studies. Mostly I'll talk a little bit about some isotope work. So next. And we were really sort of interested in sort of, you know, is there population genetic structure of yellow perch? So is it sort of one big population where everyone's sort of breeding? Or is there, you know, certain parts or certain habitats where the fish only breed amongst themselves? And then we were particularly interested in these drowned river mouse in black. Like, are those different from Lake Michigan? This just shows you our sampling sites. We sampled 14 drowned river mouse. We had some yellow perch from Lake Michigan at two sites. And then we sampled some different habitats within the drowned river mouse. So we'd sample in the summer, we'd sample littoral habitats. In the late fall, early winter, we'd sample some deeper parts of the lake. And then we had the Lake Michigan fish. Next. So we had almost 1,000 fish, and then we did, you know, that's just about the kind of genetic analysis we did. And so the thing here is this kind of gives you a summary of the genetic analysis. And again, I'm not going to get into the details, but basically if the color represents sort of the lineage of the yellow perch is one way to think about it. So you can see that if we go to the next, that the Lake Michigan sites in the north and south look more similar. Next. But if we look at the drowned river mouth lakes and don't think about the deep habitats right now, you can see those look different. And so that suggests that, you know, genetically the yellow perch and the drowned river mouth lakes are not, there's not a lot of gene flow with the fish out in Lake Michigan. But let's focus in and see what's going on with these sites where we sampled both littoral and deep water. Next, one more. And if we look at those, we have these pairs. So you can see like in Pentwater Lake in the littoral zone, which would be on the left, it's different from Pentwater Lake in the deep, which is when we sampled the deeper part of the lake in the fall. And basically those fish look a lot like the Lake Michigan fish, right? And so what we think this data shows is that the anglers were right in that we have this seasonal migration of yellow perch from Lake Michigan are moving into the drowned river mouth lake. Sort of interesting, like we don't really know why they're doing it, but it is pretty neat that they are doing it. And if they are spawning in the drowned river mouths, they're doing it in such a way that they're not really spawning with the fish that are residents in the drowned river mouths. So kind of interesting. I sort of would hypothesize they're probably just going in there and maybe using it for foraging opportunities in the winter, and then those fish go back to Lake Michigan somewhere to spawn. In terms of the seasonal dynamics, those deep habitats that where we see the yellow perch in the fall, early winter, we tried sampling yellow perch there in the summer and we don't see them. And part of that is probably because a lot of those places dissolved oxygen concentration in the summer is gonna be kind of low, like I showed you earlier. So the yellow perch are probably not gonna wanna be in those habitats. And then the one question sort of remains is where are these yellow perch and the resident fish going? You know, it would be really neat to do some telemetry work to try to get at that, but we haven't been able to get any funding to do that quite yet. Then there are some other colleagues we're collaborating with at Purdue University, and they did some isotope analyses on both otoliths, which is like the ear bone in the head, and tissue. And basically the isotope work matched up with the genetic work. So that if you looked at the, you know, the fish in Lake Michigan were different from the drowned river mouth fish we collected in littoral habitat, sort of suggesting that there were residents in each habitat, and that the isotope work also sort of suggested that we had Lake Michigan fish that had Lake Michigan signatures where we were catching them in the drowned river mouth. So again, providing additional evidence that the anglers were correct about the seasonal movement. And so sort of the last thing I wanted to end with is some fisheries management implications. So this is some creel survey data from the Michigan Department of Natural Resources. And these are two different drowned river mouths. But if you focus on Muskegon, you can see orange is harvest out of the drowned river mouth lake. And then the yellow crosshatch bar is in Lake Michigan, that there's more harvest in the drowned river mouth lake than Lake Michigan. So that's kind of interesting then to think about, well, what proportion of the fish being harvested in the drowned river mouth lake are resident yellow perch versus how many of those are actually Lake Michigan yellow perch that are just, you know, come in there and get harvested. And it might have some implications for just thinking about what creel limits should be or how we model harvest in Lake Michigan and some things like that. So that's sort of an ongoing project we have where we're going to try to get some tissue data from anglers to look at, do some genetic and isotope analyses on that tissue to see the fish that the anglers are catching, especially in the winter. Do those fish tend to be more resident fish from the drowned river mouth, or does that like look like they're fish from Lake Michigan? Next. And so this also shows you in Muskegon Lake, this is the DNR's creel survey data. And again, you can see there's a lot of harvest in February. So there's a lot of ice fishing that goes on in some of these drowned river mouths. And again, you know, the question is those fish in the winter, especially, that's when those Lake Michigan fish would expect to be in the drowned river mouth. So we're sort of interested in what proportion of those fish that are being harvested are residents versus migrants. So a couple of conclusions are, one, I think hopefully I've convinced you that drowned river mouths are important fish habitats. You know, great place for anglers. You're going to see both resident fish there, but there's also going to be some migratory species that are using the drowned river mouths. In terms of connectivity, I think I've hopefully convinced you with yellow perch, at least, it looks like they're seasonally using those habitats. So it's important from a management angle to think about that when we're setting our regulations. And then finally, just to give you sort of you know, based on the work that I've done, if we think about yellow perch, you know, yellow perch are clearly using drowned river mouth lakes as residents. There's also fish, so resident in the drowned river mouth, resident in Lake Michigan, and then we definitely have evidence for Lake Michigan fish that seasonally use the drowned river mouth. And then one thing I didn't have time to talk about today, but I'll sort of leave you with it. If you're interested, you could ask me questions. Is in the Muskegon River, there's also a lake sturgeon population. And, you know, we were sort of interested. We've done some work, telemetry work on both juveniles and adults to kind of get a sense of, is the drowned river mouth basically a conduit for those lake sturgeon to move through, to get to the rivers, to spawn? And we found evidence that the drowned river mouth is a nursery habitat for the juveniles, and that even the adults are using the drowned river mouth 12 months a year and it sort of, you know, more so than I think we thought originally. So again, sort of suggests that a lot of these drowned river mouths might be important habitats for fish. So with that, I'd be happy to take any questions.
Thanks.
Are the sturgeon from the ancient reproduction, or were they implanted here, those ones in the
Gators? Nope, So the question is, are the lake sturgeon sort of native and or were they extirpated from the Muskegon River? And they aren't. I mean, it's a remnant population. So the numbers going, you know, it's, you know, we don't know exactly, but I would think a pretty good guesstimate would be maybe 100 fish a year, maybe more, come back to spawn every year. Lake sturgeon don't spawn every single year, but about 100 fish would come back each year. If you read some of the historical stuff, I mean, they talk about places in the Muskegon River where you could almost like, you know, walk across the backs of lake sturgeon. So I think it's sort of hard to imagine you know, if you could go back in time 200 years ago, what the lake sturgeon run would look like relative to what it is today, but they were never extirpated from the Muskegon River.
Well, this is our break period too, so feel free to keep asking questions, but also feel free to get up and use bathroom or get some more food or anything like that as well. And we'll start again in about 10 minutes.
Hey.
Yep.
I haven't seen the rest of that fish community. That's pretty cool.
Yeah. All right.